Good day. I am Dr. Andrea Cristina Baliton Beligaño. I am a practicing obstetrician gynecologist from Davao City. And today we will be discussing a topic on prenatal. This is a very vital OB service that you should know. And you must be able to be familiar with the basic prenatal skills so that you'll be able to properly handle our patients. So for prenatal care, it consists of preconceptional care, ideally if you are able to catch the patient early on, prompt diagnosis of pregnancy, is your patient really pregnant? Initial prenatal evaluation, you have to evaluate the patient's wellness. And then after that, you will have to plan the subsequent follow-up. So for the goals of the prenatal care, you have to determine the maternal status. Also, you have to determine the fetal health status, estimate the age of gestation, and initiate a plan for the continuing prenatal care. So you have to be able to diagnose if your patient is really pregnant. How can you do so? There are signs and symptoms of pregnancy, which will be elaborated later, the beta-HCG level, and also sonography. So for the signs and symptoms, there would be breast and skin changes. There would be breast tenderness, there would be hyperpigmentation of the patient's certain parts like the nape and the armpit and the inguinal area. There will be perception of fetal movement, which we call as quickening. It will be perceived earlier for the multigravid at 16 to 18 weeks. It will be a little bit later at 18 to 20 weeks for the primary gravida, and it will be detected by the examiner at around 20 weeks. So what are the signs of pregnancy? It is divided into presumptive sign, baka, probable, mukhang, buntis, and then the positive sign of pregnancy. Presumptive sign are the following: amenorrhea, nausea and vomiting, urinary frequency, quickening, perception of fetal movement, perception of parang uterine enlargement, and then pigmentational changes. All of these presumptive signs of pregnancy are under the category presumptive because these can be also noted in some other medical conditions. Next would be probable sign. Probable sign would be Goodell's, Heger's, and Chadwick's sign. This pertains to the cervix, no? The Goodell's is softening of the cervix. The Heger's is the, by the way, it's smooth, uterine is smooth, and the Chadwick's is the bluish discoloration of the cervix. There would be also Braxton Hicks contractions that might be perceived by the patient who are probably pregnant. And then a positive pregnancy test. Bakit probable? Because remember, sometimes there would be false positive pregnancy results, especially if this being taken by a regular pregnancy test kit. Okay, so what is a positive sign that you're certain that your patient is actually pregnant? Then there will be fetal heart sounds. You'll be able to hear fetal heart sounds whether you're using a Doppler or you're using a stethoscope. And then outline and of a baby via ultrasound. So surely this patient is pregnant kasi may baby ka makita on ultrasound. Next would be the detection of the beta-HCG. We have cutoff values. The serum beta-HCG becomes positive in the urine at 8 to 9 days after the ovulation. There would be cutoff values with the sa amin sa ultrasound. There is a discriminatory level of around 1,000 to 2,000 level of the beta-HCG. It will double, no? The value will be doubled within 1.4 to 2 days. And then it will peak at 60 to 70 days and will plateau around 16 weeks, the beta-HCG level. So on sonography, you will see an embryo. The threshold for the embryo detection is when you see an embryonic disc, which will measure around 1 to 2 millimeters in length. And usually this is appreciated around 5 to 6 weeks age of gestation, or when the mean sac diameter on ultrasound will be around 5 to 12 millimeters. So on sonography, at 6 weeks, you will see fetal heartbeat. No? The embryo will be seen adjacent to the yolk sac, and there will be fetal cardiac activity that will be perceived at 6 weeks. If you do not see this, then you will probably be dealing with a possible failed pregnancy, you have to evaluate this 2 weeks after from the day of the ultrasound. So at up to 12 weeks, the age of gestation is very reliable, predictive, no? 12 weeks is a crown rump length. Okay, the variability or the discrepancy of the estimation of the expected date of confinement would be around 4 days to 7 days. No, contrary, compared to the later pregnant ultrasound evaluation, the expected date of delivery would be, the difference would be from 7, 10, 14 days na ang kanyang discrepancy. So as if you can catch the patient early on, if you can do an ultrasound early on in the first trimester, it would be a lot better, especially if your patient has irregular menses. So let's talk about first on terminologies. These are terminologies that you have to be familiar with. Okay, so you have to be familiar with this so that you'll be speaking the same language with your patient, and even when you're dealing with other doctors, the same doctors or general doctor or an obstetrician in particular. So we'll start with a newly gravid. A woman who has never been pregnant, you call the patient newly gravid. If it is a gravid, she has been pregnant regardless of whether those pregnancies reach term or beyond 20 weeks. Okay? Nuli para, a woman who has never completed a pregnancy, she was pregnant, but her pregnancies did not reach 20 weeks, then you will say that the patient is a nuli para. A primi para, a woman who has delivered only once of a fetus with an age of gestation more than 20 weeks. And then subsequently, multipara, nakailang anak na siya na has reached more than 20 weeks age of gestation, whether or not these pregnancies or these babies were alive today. All right, a parturient is a woman in labor, while a puerpera is a woman who has just given birth. Okay, another one, LNMP. How do you ask this? Okay, you have to be certain about this. You have to be sure about this when you're asking the patient. When you say last normal menstrual period, it means the first day of the last normal menstrual period. You have to emphasize, because if your patient has, like for instance, 3 days menstruation or 5 days menstruation, if they will give you the last day of the last normal menstrual period, then you will have erroneous computation of the age of gestation of your patient. You have to emphasize. You have to go to the level of the language that your patient understands. If your patient understands it in Bisaya or your patient is speaking in Tagalog, you have to ask this in their language, because sometimes they will really, most of the time, they will give you the last day of the last normal menstrual period. So when we're talking, then we have to be sure. No, it should be clear among us that when we're talking about the last normal menstrual period, it is the first day of the last normal menstrual period. While the past menstrual period pertains to the previous, no, the previous menstruation pertaining to the last normal menstrual period, before the last normal menstrual period. We also have expected date of delivery or the expected date of confinement. This is what your patient will take note. Also tayo. Now, we have to take note of this so that we'll be able to know when your patient is expected to be delivered. If beyond that, then probably you will be dealing with, you'll be more vigilant, you know. You have to check the fetal movement. You have to check the level of the amniotic fluid. And probably you have to induce the labor on these patients if they don't go in labor beyond the age, expected date of confinement. All right? Now, talking about obstetrical score, we have this, no? G, the P, and the open and close parenthesis, FPAL, no? G pertains to the gravidity, the P pertains to the parity, and in the open and close parenthesis, FPAL, full term, preterm, abortion, and ilan doon ang buhay, or all of it buhay ba? So you have to be able to write this properly. It should be part of your diagnosis, no? All right. Like any other patient, like any other department, be it internal medicine or pediatric or surgery, history is very important. History is standard operating procedure. You have to always take proper history. Pertains to past medical history, family history, personal social history, because it will guide you on how you will be able to handle your patient in the subsequent days, no, how you go about it. Meron ba siyang previous surgery? Meron ba siyang, was she admitted before? Does she have any hereditofamilial diseases or current disease that could affect her present pregnancy? The personal social, I ask. In the clinic, I always ask this. I always ask my patient. Kasi dun ko nag-gauge if what kind of patient am I dealing with. Is she educated? Is she not educated? Can she comply with my management? Is this patient emotionally or physically abused? Meron ba siyang mental health problem other than the present pregnancy that we are dealing with? No? So it should always be routine that you do the history before you even go on with a physical examination. All right. History includes a menstrual history, the length of her menses, meron ba siya dysmenorrhea, ilang araw ba siya, the last normal menstrual period, the past menstrual period. Obstetrical score, you have to take note of this, especially if your patient is a multigravid, no? You have to ask about the previous pregnancy, modes of delivery, birth weight of the previous baby, are there complications when she had her delivery? So ba siya nanganak, all right? And then for the present pregnancy, you have to ask if she have any certain medical conditions, pre-pregnancy weight, history of maternal illness. You have to take note of this especially on the first time that you see your patient. You have to take note of this in the patient's chart. Okay, so the normal duration of pregnancy is 280 days or 40 weeks. Okay, this is divided into three trimesters, the first, second, and the third. The first trimester is up to 14 weeks. The second trimester is up to 28 weeks. And the third trimester is up to 42 weeks. Okay, so for the age of gestation, when you do compute the NIGELs, you compute the expected date of delivery, you can use the NIGELs rule wherein you'll be adding 7 days from the last normal menstrual period and you go 3 months backward because the pregnancy duration is around 9 months, no? Okay, physical examination, obstetrical examination in particular. Let's start with the physical examination. As soon as the patient comes in, you have to take the blood pressure, basic vital signs, and then as soon as the patient comes in, you have to, you know, look at your patient. You have to do a general survey, the gait of your patient, habits of your patient, the demeanor of your patient. You have to take note of that, okay? And then you will be doing the Lupo's maneuver, so that you'll be able to determine where you will get your fetal heart rate, you could be able to determine the presentation of the baby, all right, and the fetal heartbeat. Okay, together with an obstetrical examination, you can also do speculum. You can do, even if your patient is pregnant, you can do speculum examination, especially if your patient is complaining of abnormal vaginal discharge, vaginal bleeding, and you have to do speculum examination. You can also do pap smear on these patients. You can also do digital pelvic examination. You have to check for you to be able to check the cervix. And then fetal presenting part, you can also appreciate. You can also assess the fetal bony pelvis, the maternal bony pelvis, so that you'll be able to know if you have an adequate pelvis, whether the passenger or the baby can pass through, no? Can pass through the maternal pelvis. And you also have to check the vulva and the perineum for any lesions, okay? So next would be fetal heartbeat. If you have a very good Doppler, the expensive ones, no, yung mga hot plate, you can actually appreciate the FHT at around 10 weeks, no, as early as 10 weeks. Na nakukuha na, na-catch na ng mga Dopplers, ng mga high-end Dopplers. No? Meron namang mga mura na Dopplers, medyo nahihirapan sila. They can start hearing FHT mga 16 weeks, no? So using your stethoscope, you can be able to hear the FHT at around 20 weeks, no? All right. The pundit height you get from the symphysis pubis up to the fundus. Take note, if your patient is obese, you have to identify the fundus. Now you do not follow the maternal fat, no? You should be able to identify where the fundus is, and that's the pundit height. Okay, it correlates well with the pundic height, correlates well with the age of gestation from between 20 to 34 weeks age of gestation. And remember, when you're taking the pundic height, the bladder must be empty. Before, bago pa man pumasok ang patient, you tell them they have to empty their bladder. Okay. I cannot overemphasize this one na age of gestation, kailangan from the start na establish na natin ito. Whether you're using the last normal menstrual period or you'll be basing it with the earliest ultrasound that your patient have. Swerte ka, if you have an early ultrasound, your first trimester ultrasound wherein the crown rumblent was measured, so that you'll be able to determine the expected date of confinement. Okay, especially for patients who have irregular menses, yung mga polycystic ovarian, suddenly they got pregnant, they're not really sure when their LMP was. Okay? So, gestational age, you can use the last normal menstrual period. You can also correlate it with the fundicide. Quickening, no? Kasi pwede mo siyang i-put together, no? The LMP, perception of fetal movement, kailan, and then you correlate with the fundicide kung tutugma ba, no? But then the fundicide, hindi rin reliable if you are dealing with a twin pregnancy, polyhydramnios, or merong mga adnexal mass or uterine mass, ma-alter yung fundicide. Okay? Your ultrasound is a great help, no? You have come to the age of medicine where we have the aid of an ultrasound, no? So everything else is a lot easier, no? With an aid of an ultrasound, lalo-lalo if you have the earliest ultrasound. So for the surveillance, for the fetal, every time your patient comes in for prenatal, you have to get the heart rate, you have to check if it's gaining weight, no? Lumalaki ba yung fundicide, the amount of amniotic fluid, if you have your ultrasound, the fetal presenting part. And you ask them, is there the fetal movement? Kasi sila, yung mommy eh, the mommy knows kung malikot ba yung baby nila. So you ask, kusog ba mulihok si baby? Is there active fetal movement pertaining to the fetal status? No? Kasi silang nakakaalam. And then the maternal, again, blood pressure, physical examination. And when the patient comes in, you ask, from the last time I saw you, has there been any headache, any changes in your symptoms? Meron bang bleeding? No? Is there any contractions that you felt? Or dysuria for that matter, or anything else that you've noted that's different from the last time that you saw your patient. Again, you get the fundicide, you can do any vaginal examination kung may mga complaint, and then if it's almost term, then you can do determine the presentation. Okay? So, together with the prenatal, kasama yung laboratory at ancillary test. Of course, you have to do blood test. No? You have to know if your patient's anemic, mababa ba yung platelet? What is the blood type? You have to know. And then, urinalysis. Ideally, gold standard is urine culture. Pero in the low-resource setting, we can do with urinalysis na lang. No? You also screen for GDM. If it's your patient is high risk, what is high risk? Mataba. No? Your patient has a strong family history of GDM. Then the first time you saw the patient, you should screen for GDM. When you request for oral glucose tolerance test, that's a 75 gram oral glucose tolerance test. Sorry. So if hindi naman, payat yung patient, no family history, previous pregnancies, walang GDM, then you can start screening at 24 to 28 weeks. And again, if it is negative and you're suspicious, merong weight gain, merong the baby is medyo malaki, then you can screen again at 32 weeks. Okay? And then, again, ultrasound. No? Hindi lang once mag-ultrasound. Minsan, some patients later na, doc, pag nakikita na yung gender. So we have to correct them. No? You have to make them understand the role of ultrasound, especially if there are mga abnormal findings. No? Merong abnormal findings, then the ultrasound will not be done just once. Okay? Depende yun. So, hindi lang siya on the first trimester, hindi lang siya only on the second trimester, but it depends, no? So, probably once in every trimester, we have to evaluate the baby. Okay? So, this is a GDM result. No? These are the cutoffs. You have to take note of this so that you'll be able to know if your patient, you're dealing with a patient who's GDM. Okay? So, ano? Kaya pa ba? Andiyan pa ba? May audience pa ba ako? Because we are still halfway through, no? Halfway through pa tayo. So let's proceed. So screening. Screening includes rubella testing. In the first world countries, they do this, no? Rubella testing, syphilis routine ito. hepatitis B screening, HBsAg screening, syphilis. Routine ito. Part ito ng routine laboratory test that we request for our patients. And we can also do pap smear and vaginal and rectal for group B streptococcal infection. We can do it. We do it at 35 to 37 weeks. No, near term na tayo according to the CDC at saka sa ACOG. Alright? If your patient is high risk, actually, the HIV testing is also routine, but patient, it's they can opt not to be tested. But if you're suspicious of your patient, parang high risk siya for HIV, especially positive yung syphilis, then you have to do the HIV testing. Okay? And the subsequent prenatal visit, the interval would be every 4 weeks, monthly, hanggang 28 weeks. And then it will be every 2 weeks after 28 weeks up to 36 weeks. And then weekly thereafter. Kasi papunta na tayo term, we should be more closely monitoring our patients. No? Kasi biglang matataas ang BP, biglang magle-labor, biglang mag-rupture ang bag of water. Then you have to be seeing the patient more frequently pag term na. Okay, in every visit, you check the mother, you check the baby also every time. So, meron dito sa slide 15 to 20 weeks in the first world country, they do this, no? The maternal serum alpha fetal protein for screening of mga chromosomal, mga congenital anomalies. They have that. Medyo pricey kasi. We have that na in the country, pero medyo expensive pa siya. And it's not part of the insurances, so it's not routinely done. Cystic fibrosis, hindi naman din common ito sa atin, sa Philippines. No? So, we don't routinely do this. At 24 to 28 weeks, you screen for diabetes. You check again the hemoglobin of your patients. Complete CBC na lang, no? And then, ROGAM, no? First world country, they usually do this. More than 28 weeks, you screen for syphilis again, chlamydia if your patient is high risk, no? And then, the GBS screening. Alright. So, in the subsequent visit, it was mentioned earlier, yun ay para sa low risk. If your patient is high risk, then you have to be doing the prenatal. You have to see the patient more often. Every 1 to 2 weeks, gano'n, no? So, mas often yung silang dapat makita. So early on in the first time you saw the patient, then that's why you have to check the maternal status and the fetal status. Kasi dun mo malalaman, if you're dealing with a high-risk patient or a low-risk patient. So, magdadepende doon how often you have to see the patient. Okay? After that, you have to take note also of the nutrition of your patient. Okay? Let's start with folic acid. The folic acid is 400 microgram preconception and also in the first trimester. But if your patient has a previous history of a neural tube defect, no, nagkaanak siya na may neural tube defect, may bukol dito, mga ganon. So you have to give as much as 4 milligram per day. If you will look at the preparation of the mga folic acid supplements, nasa mga 4 to 5 milligrams naman yung preparation. So that would suffice, no? So, yun, you give as much as that in your patient because you want to prevent neural tube defect in their baby. Diet alone cannot suffice, no? Usually naman kasi sa mga vitamins, mga gulay, ganun, meron folic. Pero we're not sure na how we prepare our foods, how these foods are being processed. So, we have to give supplementation, okay? Next would be iron, right? 27 milligrams per day. If your patient is obese, if your patient is anemic, if you have having twin pregnancy, irregular intake ng iron, late na nag-iron, then you give as much as 60 to 100 milligrams per day. Okay? If your patient is anemic, no, the baby will get as much. The selfish yung baby. Kukunin niya kung anong para sa kanya. So the mother will be suffering really here if you're dealing with a patient who's anemic. Siya yung magsasuffer. Easy fatigability, may mga cardiac complications din. So you have to give iron supplementation. Take note of this, ha. Hindi naman siya strict na as soon as your patient is pregnant. Remember, nagsusuka pa yung patient in the first trimester and magbibigay ka pa ng iron, you will induce more vomiting on your patient. So pwede naman later na lang, after the first trimester. Alright, so it must be taken on an empty stomach. So before meal, ito ipainom sa patient nyo, magtatanong, no? Kailan po iinomin? So So you have to emphasize before meal, before meal or at bedtime. It should not be taken with calcium, because if you take it together with calcium, the absorption of iron together with calcium would be less, no? So hindi sila sabay. Because kasi yung calcium ay taken after meal, no? After kain. So technically hindi sila sabay. Okay, the recommended dietary the requirement, no, allowance for calcium would be 1000 milligrams per day. No, so some supplements would be coming in with 1000, meron 600, meron 500. So take note lang of those, no? So if inadequate kasi ito sa mommy, there would be demineralization again. No, the baby will get what is due for him or her. Okay, so the mother will suffer. So you look at patients who are in the low socioeconomic status, walang mapambili ng vitamins, poor yung nutrition, at multigravid, no, gravida 10, gravida 8, mga ganon, wala silang ngipin, no? They lose their teeth, no? That's how the body would act on it, no? So they have to give up to the baby, and so they have to give up the teeth, no? So yung mga multigravid, malnourished, walang ngipin. All right? So protein, 71 grams per day. Okay, this is very important for the growth of the baby, the placenta, and the uterus. Okay, so we get this from the food, mga milk and egg, no, cheese, mga poultry products. Napuha natin doon. Vitamin B12 prevents neural tube defect also. We get this from mga meat products, no? So yung mga vegetarian, they are very prone to be vitamin B12 deficient. So the requirement would be 2.6 micrograms per day. Alright? Also, we have vitamin D. So yung mga calcium, incorporated na rin yung vitamin D. Now, but there are also supplements that vitamin D lang siya talaga. Alright? May mga preparations na ganun. The recommended would be 15 micrograms per day or 600 IU per day. Okay, it prevents rickets, mga congenital rickets, mga skeletal problems on the baby. So you have to give, no? Okay, especially sa mga limited sun exposure, yung sa mga may snow, ganon, and they're pregnant during those time, wala namang sun during those time, then you have to give vitamin D, no, for your patient. Next would be iodine. So importante ito. Usually in the past some patients are deficient sa iodine sa especially mga mountainous areas. They don't get access to mga seafoods, no? So your recommended dietary allowance is 220 micrograms per day, pero they have dealt with it already. They have introduced an iodized salt, so it would suffice, no? So we will try to prevent neonatal cretinism. So that's why we need iodine. Okay, so that would be about the vitamins. Next would be vaccination. Of course, our pregnant patient would need vaccination, no? There are vaccines that must be given to these patients during pregnancy and can be given during pregnancy. You have to also take note of those vaccines na hindi pwedeng ibigay during pregnancy. All right, so you can give inactivated influenza, flu vaccine. We have the TD, tetanus, diphtheria, or the Tdap, no, tetanus, diphtheria, and acellular pertussis, no. There had been during the pandemic, there had been poor, no, poor vaccination noong time na yon, and so it resulted to medyo nag-recur, no. Now, there had been reported. There have been areas reported to have recurrence of pertussis. We have eliminated na ito, no? We have eliminated this already, but then due to the poor vaccination during the COVID times, bumalik together with measles and this one, pertussis. So vaccines you cannot give, herpes zoster, varicella, you cannot give active live attenuated na influenza. You cannot give MMR. You cannot give smallpox vaccine. So question, HPV vaccine, can we give? I had my first dose. Then I didn't know I'm pregnant. My next dose would be in 1 month's time. So, do I get the next dose? No, hindi na natin i-continue. We will give the next dose after your pregnancy. Now, the question would be, I don't know if I was already pregnant from the time that I had my first dose. Will it affect my baby? Hindi naman. No, wala naman siyang ganong effect. Wala naman siyang congenital effect on the baby. But then, we just don't continue it. No? After na lang ng pregnancy, the human papillomavirus vaccine, no? To prevent cervical cancer. If your patient got the first or second dose, tapos biglang nabuntis siya, then you will continue to complete the next doses after the pregnancy. Okay, so influenza, given in any trimester, no, you have to ask lang if your patient has mga allergies to previous flu vaccine or mga egg, no? Egg allergies or an active may Guillain-Barré syndrome you cannot give, no? So, pertussis is given from 27 to 36 weeks. I had my pregnancy last year. Will I get Tdap ulit ngayon? You have. Every pregnancy you have to get. You have to get the Tdap. Okay? Next would be hepatitis. Can be given during pregnancy, no? The A and B. Especially if medyo high risk yung patient mo. You're in an environment na high risk for hepatitis. Your patient has STD. Mga ganon, no? So, has a partner who has a hepatitis positive or siya mismo positive, no? Then you have to give hepatitis A and B vaccination anytime during pregnancy. Okay? Pneumococcal, if your patient is high risk to having pneumonia during pregnancy, you compromise yung patient mo, you can give it if it is highly needed, no? Pwedeng ibigay sa buntis. Alright, next. Rabies. Puso to, no? Mga fur parents, mga fur family, merong mga ganon, no? So, na-scratch, na-bite, naglalaro-laro sa animal, na-bite, na-scratch. So, they can get vaccinated. It is safe for pregnancy. They should get vaccinated. Okay? So, this is quite a busy slide. I think this is my last slide. All right, so you can just take a screenshot of this. I got this from the CDC. All right, I mentioned earlier about the HPV vaccine. Before pregnancy, pwede, pero during pregnancy, hindi. After pregnancy, na lang. So you just go through with this. And with that, thank you for your kind attention. And if you have questions, you can... type in, no? That's a group chat for any questions. So I will try to answer them, maybe not immediately, but I will answer. Okay? So thank you for your kind attention.